is really, I mean, pretty much off the charts here. Just that wall of balls. It's like you have a guy who does it, or, I mean, the way you choreograph it.
Well, here's what happened. We started at Memphis because we won a couple games. We didn't play any ranked opponents in our building my first I mean, it was like, then we beat somebody, we did a ball, and we did it. Then we went back and did some of the Massachusetts balls of ranked teams. And then some of the, my first college win, the 100th college win, the 300th or whatever. And then, but here what happens is every game you play is someone ranked. So I'm like, I don't know. So we got some balls in the backlog, but we don't know what.
Not enough balls.
We're like, what do we do with them?
Nice problem to have.
Yeah, hopefully.
But just, you know, the little stuff, the not so little stuff, the championship ring, just walking around, I'm like, to me, an office says a lot about a person. Whether it's a CEO of a major corporation, CEO of a basketball team.
This is the favorite stuff. Every team I've coached.
What does it say about John Calipari, this office? What do you think it says?
That there's probably, this is a recruiting office more than him getting work done. So, do we have sunshine laws here? If we did and they said, we need the stuff out of your desk, there's a comb in this one. There's a couple pair of socks in
there
the other
go.
Drawer.
There you go.
There's a... You know,
Abraham Lincoln behind your dad. I'm a huge Lincoln fan. Are you a fan
of
Lincoln?
Yeah, I am.
Why are you a fan of Lincoln?
I just have been, I've read things, and I'm really respectful of a guy who, in the eye of a storm, stayed the course. People called him everything under the sun. He didn't listen. He knew who he was, comfortable in his own skin, knew what he had to do, driven, failure, did not, you know, and I had some depression and some other things going on that he had to fight and battle, and but just like, wow, how strong was this guy? So, but
that's quite cool. He's one of my favorites also. I mean, to me, finding out stuff like that says something about you. I mean, because you have a job that this isn't always rosy and sunshine.
Well, here's what's happened since I've been here. I don't see myself in the business of basketball as much as I see myself now in the business of helping families. We coach basketball. We teach them how to dribble and shoot. Different here. I'm in Kentucky now. I've always been about kids and their families. But we've had 15 drafted.
That's unbelievable. Really.
In the last 3 years. We had a 3.2 grade point average this term. 9 players over a B average. 9. We had... a 3.0 average the year before. So it's not like what I say is, well, they don't go to school, they don't care about that. You could say it over and over and over and over and over. It still doesn't make it true. It's not true. So we've graduated 7. So now you look at it and you say, you're in the business of helping families. Well, how about breaking the generational cycle? Generational lack of education. It's just been broken. How about generational poverty? I'm walking into these homes, I'm not talking 10 years, 200 years of poverty. That cycle has been changed now. You're talking about teaching them to be family members, to teaching them to be fathers, men, teaching them what it means to be a husband, because they watch us, because we're all married. So now all of a sudden you say, we're not in the business of coaching basketball, we're in the business of helping families change generational cycles. And now it's a little bit more powerful. And a little more lasting, a little more meaningful to me. Would I like to win more championships and national? Yes. But if we can continue just changing families and helping families change generational cycles, that other stuff happens.
You have a number of critics. Why do you think you have so many critics? I mean, here I'm going to try to answer my own question. You stir the pot. You push the boundaries in almost everything you do. But is that the way you see it? Well, there are critics all over the place. Is it just because you're a successful person?
I don't think there's as many as you're saying, but when someone says, well, I don't like him, I tell them, get in line. No, no, it's back then. Just back. Keep walking. You keep going and around the corner. Here's my point. You're judged emotionally during the time you're here. Let's look back 50 years from now and not just winning basketball games, changing families. What have we done in the communities? What have we done in the charitable aspects? What have my wife and I done to help change? People look back 50 years from now and say, wow, this is him. They don't have the emotion that I'm writing books and attached to this coach and I'm killing this other guy. Or I'm attached to this coach and I'm killing this guy. And all of a sudden the perception you have has been built by whoever. The one thing that's changed now is this social media and social networking and all this stuff. For me personally, I get a chance to be transparent. So now you can think what you want, but you're going to get a chance to see who I am, what I'm about, sure. Not through the eyes of this guy.
Sure.
And not through the eyes of that guy. Through, here it is.
Is it fair to say that you do push? I remember you talking China at one point last year, 2 years ago. And frankly, I'm saying this in a
sure.
complimentary way. You take a box and you blow it up. Is that fair? And
well, I don't. You know, what's happening for us right now in basketball, I'll give you an example. It's never been done in the history of our game, and it wasn't by design. We're just trying to help young people and their families. But all these kids leaving early, I don't even like one and done. I don't think it's good for kids or basketball, high school, college, or pro. But it's a rule. So now what do? Do I convince kids that they should stay? Do I hold kids back and demean them and just go crazy so they can't leave? Do I play mind games, or do I help them chase their dreams and they leave? And now figure it out. And then all of a sudden, it looked around and more kids want to come because those kids got, and then more kids want to come. It wasn't by design, but it happened. Now everybody's mad at me because he didn't care about college athletics. I just told you, 3.2 grade point average, 8-9 kids over. Who did better? If anybody in college basketball did better than my team academically, bring them out. Obviously, you didn't do better on the basketball court. Okay. Now, I don't think you did better in the classroom. I don't think you did better in the community. I know you didn't do better in the draft room. 1 and 2 and 6 draft, the first time in the history of our sport. But if I see, again, I'm Italian. You attack me, I'm attacking you.
Sure.
You hit one of mine, I'm hitting two of yours. You hurt one of mine, I'm burning down your village. I'm not going to sit there.
Sure.
And let you, now, in my earlier days, I did. So you got hit and just let it go, and all of a sudden the perception and every who you are, I'm done now with that. I'm not going to coach that much longer. So I go out swinging. But I'll say this. As long as I'm worried about these kids and their families, as long as it's a players first program, I'm going to enjoy every day of what I do. When you make it about yourself, me. What happens is, life becomes difficult because it's all about you.
Sure.
I want to be about my secretary and her family, my staff becoming head coach. I don't beat my staff up. The responsibility and the buck stops right on this desk. If things aren't working right, it is my fault. If we're not signing kids, it is my fault. I'm not beating those guys up. I want to be here for them. As long as I'm about everyone else, life becomes easier. And you know what? You find out you win a whole lot more games. And when you make it about you, you're that tight because everything is about how you are and what you're about. I'm not that way. Now, somebody out there could say, oh, he's full of crap. He is that way. You could say that. And you know what? Whatever you think of me, here's what I'd say. I agree. So it doesn't matter to me. Whatever you think. You think that? I agree.
Let me get one hardcore question. I'm running out of time. The obvious question, you're ranked top 5, you hardly have anybody back.
How can we be ranked top 5? Do you think it's they're trying to put it on Cal? Or do you think they're trying to help Kentucky?
Reputation.
You know, you say that. We have not, in 72 teams in BCS, there's only one team that has no player back that has started any games. Us. We're it. And we're top 5? That's great. Top 3? Some have them too. What? We have Kyle Wilshire back, who did not start a game and played. That's it. Do I like my team? I really like my team. But we may lose to Maryland Duke to start the season.
Sure.
And then we'll go from there.
But by March?
I like my team. By March, unless I'm not seeing something, I like my team. We need to stay healthy. We need to keep growing like we do historically. If history talks about what we're going to do, we'll go like that. And by March, we'll be good. But there's a lot of work between now and then. Having to find players. What we try to do is have them play to their strengths. I don't need you to do stuff. I'm not going to pigeonhole you. We don't play Cal ball. I don't know how we're going to play. We're going to press? Maybe. Maybe not. Are we going to play hard? Yes. Are we going to play fast? Yes. What kind of offense are we going to run? The end of it will be dribble drive. How much dribble drive? I don't know until I get the team out there. What if we play two big guys? I've never coached a 7-footer and a 6'11", two big guys at one time. In my career, guess what? I better figure it out because I got two really good big guys. Now, will they play together all the time? No. But what about 10, 15 minutes a game? So we got there's a lot of challenges. But as you can tell, I'm excited about it. Let's go. I don't know if we'll be as good as we were a year ago. Maybe we will. Is the rest of the country as good as they were a year ago? Let's hope they're not, because last year was ridiculous. The teams, that those 8 to 10 teams, those ridiculous. We just happen to be really talented and the most efficient team offensively, didn't turn it over, and the best defensive team in the country. And we just happened to have three freshmen start and two sophomores, and they all got drafted, and the sixth man got drafted. Now we start all over. That's how it's done here. Now, by me saying that, now probably another five guys got in the line at the end of the line. They're angry. How could he say it? You know the one thing? I just try to tell the truth and say what's on my mind, and I'm not BSing anybody, and here's who I am. You like it. You don't.
You're showing your age. You're about the same age, I think you get an epiphany. May I squeeze in one last question, please? There's talk of an NBA team in Louisville, the possibility, for financial reasons. I'm sure you're at least, it's on your radar a little bit. Your thoughts, would it hurt Louisville? Would it hurt Kentucky financially? Is it a good thing? Where do you stand?
Let me say this. Whatever I say, now Louisville fans are saying he's trying to hurt us, okay?
You don't have to answer this.
I'm going to say it. Okay. Has nothing to do with Louisville. Okay. They're not on my radar screen. I know how good they are.
Yeah.
We got to play them once a year.
That's really where I was going.
Okay. All right. But here's what it is. An NBA team that comes to our state makes us a professional, makes Louisville a professional city and a professional state. What happens is you think it takes away from your program.
Right.
It only steals some of the media. So instead of always being on the top column, you're going to share that. I was good with that in Memphis. I didn't need to be on the front top all the time. Matter of fact, I wanted it to be more about players and less about me. I didn't need to be up there. Here's what happens. We sold more tickets and raised more money when that NBA team came.
Why do you think that is?
Because it got more people interested in basketball. Now, the Umanas, the Yums, the Papa Johns, all those people, what'll happen is Louisville becomes even a better place to live because you have a pro franchise. It becomes a better place. Here's what happens for your athletes at Louisville and here. Every game they're playing in the Yum Center, there'll be scouts to come in to watch that team play. You know where they'll be at 3 o'clock?
Watching you guys.
Watching us practice in Louisville practice. So it's perfect for players. Now, the building's built. The practice facility's built. It's an unbelievable setup. I believe it's an ideal place for an NBA place. Even better than Memphis. Even better than Memphis. The demographics are different. The number of...
See, you would know. I'm
just telling you, it did not... Now, here's what it did do. It took away some of my outside income. So the stuff that I was able to promote and do outside income, it took that away from me.
But from the program, it didn't hurt you financially?
No, not at all. And what the school did is they made up for what I lost in outside income. So I was like, it didn't bother me in a bit.
This is a really polarizing topic. I think you're the perfect guy to ask this, and I didn't want to put you on the spot.
Yeah, but again, the Louisville people are saying he's only saying
that.
It to hope. And I'm not. I'm not.
You're that. I get. We fight and with Indiana as well, which is right, obviously right across the rivers. I appreciate you doing this.
Okay.
You've been very, very kind.
Thanks.